Lab-grown meat was just approved for sale for the first time. A chicken nugget made of cells grown in a bioreactor passed regulations in Singapore and can now be sold to the public. Dozens of companies across the globe are racing to develop similar products, from lab-grown steaks to pork, seafood, even duck à l'orange. One obvious selling point of lab-grown meats is they don't require an animal to be killed. So they eliminate the middle cow, and pig, and chicken. Of course, we know these products are going to be marketed as cruelty-free. But are they? Supposedly the cells came from a biopsy, not a dead chicken. Maybe a little creepy eating a biopsy from a chicken, but if this initial cell bank can now be grown indefinitely, it could potentially replace raising and killing billions of animals. As Forbes magazine put it, a single sample from a single cow can be used to make an almost limitless number of burgers. The other question is the growth medium. Growing cells in a lab usually requires something called fetal bovine serum, which, as the name indicates, comes from animals. But the company behind the chicken nugget says they're planning to grow their lab meats using a plant-based serum. The other exciting potential benefit of lab-grown meat is, of course, environmental impact. In general, plants have the lowest environmental impact of all foods. Most animal foods like eggs, dairy, pork, poultry, fish have 2 to 25 times more impact, and red meat has about 100 times more. That is staggering. That means one steak dinner could have a bigger environmental footprint than an entire month of eating plant-based. That's mainly because of the low efficiency of producing meat. You need to raise animals to adult size for years, then transport them, slaughter them, cut them all up, then transport them again. It's an energetic nightmare. At least in theory, lab-grown meats could really streamline this process. One study reported taking only 4 days to grow one of these lab steaks. And of course, you could have 1,000 of these growing in parallel once they scale up the process. So the environmental advantage could be huge. Indeed, the manufacturers claim that once scaled up, lab meats will produce much lower emissions and use far less water and land than conventional meat. Fingers crossed. But of course, manufacturers are going to claim that. Is it actually true? Some studies support those claims and predict lower environmental impact of cultured meats, but others raise a note of caution that it depends on exactly how they are produced. Depending on the facilities and resources used, there's a huge variation in how environmentally friendly the process is. So, bottom line, there's potential to optimize it and reduce environmental footprint, but we probably shouldn't assume that lab-grown meats are automatically more sustainable without looking into the details of how each product is made. Okay, what about the health angle? Are lab-grown meats more or less healthy than conventional? According to the manufacturers, the nutritional composition of cultured chicken is the same as conventional meat. But it'll be a while before we have rigorous studies in people actually eating them to compare. We do have a lot more control over lab-grown meat, so potentially we could tweak the composition to make them healthier. For example, we could create meat low in saturated fat. A new study combined muscle cells with different amounts of adipocytes, fat cells, to get either very lean meats or fattier cuts with different degrees of marbling. That's crazy, but we could go even further. We could engineer the meat to have not just different amounts, but different types of fat. Imagine a steak with the fat profile of walnuts or flax seeds or olive oil. Now, that study is just proof of principle. In fact, and hold on to your seats, they used rodent meat. Rat steak. Any takers? Mouse cells are more common in the lab setting, that's why they use them. But of course, the idea is to apply the technique to grow chicken or beef or whatever people want to eat. If this all sounds very sci-fi to you, you're not alone. Winston Churchill, of all people, predicted this all the way back in the 30s. With a greater knowledge of hormones, we shall escape the absurdity of growing a whole chicken to eat the breast or wing by growing these parts separately under a suitable medium. The fat content is not the only thing that will be different in lab-grown meats. They may also eliminate heme iron, the type of iron normally found in meat. Heme iron is a prooxidant that has been proposed to play a role in cancer and heart disease, although it's pretty hard to demonstrate that link with certainty. But lab-grown meats could eliminate heme iron altogether, or have different levels according to personal preference. Another factor are fecal contaminants. Because of the way these animals live and die, conventional meat can be contaminated with bacteria like E. coli and Salmonella, which can then cause food poisoning. Lab-grown meats are not exposed to feces, one would hope, so it gets rid of that factor. A related problem are antibiotic-resistant bacteria, sometimes called superbugs, which are commonly detected in meat due to widespread antibiotic use in farmed animals. If we can figure out how to grow muscle cells in the lab in a really clean environment, maybe they can be antibiotic-free and we can dodge that issue as well. Also, diseases called by having animals all packed together in filthy conditions, the so-called zoonoses, like swine flu, bird flu, those could potentially be avoided. Now, when it comes to hormones, things are a little less clear. Farmed animals are often treated with hormones to accelerate growth, and concerns are often voiced about the health effects of eating these products exposed to unnatural hormone levels. But growing cells in a lab also typically requires growth factors to stimulate multiplication, so the devil's in the details. We'll have to wait for more solid data on how each lab-grown meat is produced. And just to reiterate, the bottom line will be rigorous studies of people actually eating these foods and their actual health outcomes. So, if it's better for the animals, and potentially for health and the environment, then everybody's on board, right? Not quite. There's plenty of resistance. And this might surprise you, some of it is actually coming from animal rights advocates. Their argument is that lab-grown meats, or clean meats as they call them, will only perpetuate our dependence on meat and strengthen the same big ag industries. So they argue we should all just move toward plant-based diets and not try to put lipstick on pigs, as it were. They are right that these products will enrich the same people making money off of animal agriculture. In fact, some of the largest meat producers are already involved in the lab meat business. I guess you could say they have a stake in it, but I don't think it's realistic to expect all humans to just go vegan to save the earth. Certainly not in any reasonable time frame. Some people already don't eat meat and don't need lab-grown meats. Fine. And millions more will transition off of animal products gradually over the decades to come. But many people are just not going to do it. In fact, globally, meat consumption is actually projected to increase. It may go down in the West, but probably will go up in developing countries, and also the human population as a whole is increasing. So we'll wreck the entire planet before we get most humans to put down the stakes. That's just the psychological and cultural reality. So finding viable alternatives can be an absolute game changer. And nothing changes habits like technical innovation. Imitation meats can help too, but they don't replace all products. You can make a plant burger, but not a convincing steak, for example. So finding ways to produce actual meat that are less destructive could be a godsend. At the end of the day, whether these lab-grown meats actually stick and people buy them will hinge on two factors: taste and price. Taste shouldn't be that hard. If they figured out how to make plant burgers that taste like meat, making meat that tastes like meat should be pretty easy. In fact, people who tasted the lab-grown chicken nuggets say they taste just like chicken. Maybe because it is chicken. The price is going to need more work. Not long ago, during development, producing lab-grown chicken cost $9,000 a pound. That's a lot of coupons. Of course, as they scale things up, it'll get much cheaper. If it eventually gets to the same or lower price than conventional meats, I think it could take over. Even with taste and price under control, I'm sure there'll be some initial resistance. I mean, it's a new concept, Franken meats, and maybe acceptance will gradually increase with time. Some experts project that in 20 years, most meat will not come from slaughtered animals. Maybe for our kids and grandkids, the idea of raising an animal just to kill it will seem strange and barbaric, while meat grown in a lab will have become the norm. If you're looking for more alternatives, here's a look at imitation meats. And if you're not into meats of any kind, here's 7 great sources of plant protein.